And when things feel familiar, people feel comfortable.
Hello and welcome to the Business of Architecture. I am your host, Ryan Willard, and today I find myself in the delightful company of Jeffrey Dungan, the visionary behind Jeffrey Dungan Architects. From an early age, the rural expanses of his family abode in Alabama became a canvas for Jeffrey's blossoming in love for art and drawing, a nurturing ground where the symbiotic relationship between nature and design became deeply ingrained in him. This rural tapestry would later unfold as a rich source of inspiration, guiding his hands in crafting remarkable pieces of architecture that grace North and Central America. Recognized for reinventing classical vernaculars with a modern touch, Jeffrey stands as a refreshing voice in the architectural landscape. His work isn't merely about erecting structures, but weaving in passion, depth, and an unyielding zest that resonates well with those he collaborates with. His notable journey in the architectural sphere has been adorned with numerous accolades, including recognition from the prestigious American Institute of Architects. The coveted 2017 Southeast Architect of the Year Award was bestowed upon him by Veranda Magazine and ADAC, to name a few. Furthermore, Jeffrey's remarkable contributions have earned him a fellowship at the Institute of Classical Architecture and Art, where he has been the recipient of two prestigious Schutz Awards. Jeffrey's masterful creations have not only captured the imagination of many, but have also found a place in a myriad of books and esteemed publications such as Veranda, Lux, The Wall Street Journal, amongst others, showcasing the far-reaching impacts and appreciation for his refined yet innovative approach to architecture. A true testament to his craftsmanship, his work also features prominently in the popular lifestyle magazines such as Garden and Gun, Milieu, and Southern Living, painting a rich tapestry of a journey steeped in creativity and innovation. In this episode, Jeffrey and I discuss the importance of creating emotion and storytelling and authenticity in social media marketing and wider marketing in publications. We talk about Jeffrey's very finely curated approach to photography, why working with the best photographers is absolutely critical in being able to display your work. We talk about classical architecture and elegance and how knowing your audience and knowing your marketplace creates the backbone for a successful business. We also discuss about fees and the importance of charging high fees, premium fees, in order for you to be able to do your best possible work and deliver the best possible service for your client. So this was a wonderful delight for me. I'm a big fan of Jeffrey's work. I've sat many times and enjoyed his Instagram page, which is well worth looking at, and fantasized about sipping nice warm drinks in front of the fires that might be located in the beautiful rural landscapes within which his buildings reside. So sit back, relax, and enjoy Jeffrey Dungan. This episode is sponsored by Smart Practice, Business of Architecture's flagship program to help you structure your firm for freedom, fulfillment, and financial profit. If you want access for our free training on how to do this, please visit smartpracticemethod.com. Or if you want to speak directly to one of our advisors about how he might be able to help you, please follow the link in the information. Jeff, welcome to the Business of Architecture. How are you?
Very good. Good to be with you, Ryan.
Fantastic. Now, absolute pleasure to have you on the show. You are the principal founder of Jeffrey Dungan Architects. You're based in Alabama, and you've got one of these extraordinary portfolios of beautiful residences, interiors, boutique kind of commercial hotels, I'm imagining. You've got one of these portfolios where I've sat down with a nice cup of coffee and just fantasized about living the lives of the people that have the privilege of living inside of some of your houses. It's absolutely, absolutely gorgeous, and you know, quite an eclectic kind of architectural language that you're using, from country farmhouses to like English Tudor to to kind of influences from France and Italy and Renaissance, and obviously mixed.
Love all those different languages. It's fun to try to learn how to speak them in an architectural fashion.
And then also the kind of locations that you're working in, your portfolio of work is kind of exquisite location after exquisite location. You've got projects right across the US. I know you've done a bit of work in Ireland. Is that right?
Yeah, we did one there in outside of Dalkey, which is not too far from Dublin for a British man and his Irish lass, a sassy little thing that he married. Mm-hmm. And we're working also in West Sussex, a little closer to London now on a project. And we have a home that we're doing in Costa Rica. We just finished one in the Dominican Republic, in Canada, and really, really exotic places like California. You know, where really weird things happen. So yeah, it's been fun to get to practice in those places that some don't speak English and use the metric system.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. This has always been my stumbling block. If I've worked in America before, was my complete ignorance to using imperial measurements. Very confusing.
So it really is amazing that the metric system is a beautiful thing once you get a little bit used to it and understand it. It's just very strange when you say that the bedroom is 4x4.
You know, like a coffin.
That would be really small in the United States. So. But, you know, it's more like 16 feet square then.
So interesting that your portfolio of work has kind of expanded outside of Alabama where you're based. Say for example, the project that you're doing in West Sussex. So are you working with a local architect to have that delivered?
Yes,
or?
Yes. In that case, we are. Yeah, we sure are. And people ask sometimes, well, how do you find your clients in these places, and I think they've got the question backwards. Is, you know, they found me. Mm-hmm. in most cases through, you know, the magic of the internet and social media and all these things that we have today, that literally when I started my practice or started practicing 35 years ago, you know, we had a blueprint machine and a fax. You know, that was the bleeding edge of technology at the time. And it would have been impossible to have the kind of experience that I've had without the internet and all of the things that have come with it, and the world just becoming, you know, so much smaller than it ever has been before, maybe.
You work with a very a kind of high caliber level of client, who can be very, I'm going to imagine, very demanding, who have got quite extraordinary tastes and expectations of that kind of project. But it's also it's a very difficult group of people to romance and seduce, if you like. How did you start? How did your portfolio begin to build when you first started the
business? That's a great question. So when we first started out back in, you know, under my own, you know, practice, I worked after I got out of university for, you know, about 10 years at some different wonderful places before I started my own firm. But it was in like the late 90s. When we started, and the economy was just really robust, and people were just building, developments were going on all over the place. And we were really fortunate to get to live in an area where it was pretty easy to get to the beach. You could be at the beach in 4 hours, but you could also be up in the mountains of North Carolina in about the same amount of time. And so we quickly were being asked to, you know, work in these little boutique developments. There is a wonderful group called DPZ, Andres Duany, who has, you know, done some amazing things with, you know, developing neighborhoods and developing urbanism. And we fell in with those guys and they were doing stuff all over the country. And so all of a sudden we were kind of riding their coattails and getting a wonderful experience of working in many different styles in many different locations. So sometimes I've sort of imagined myself to be like a kind of a architectural version of Johnny Appleseed, just throwing the seeds out here and there and just trying to get as much of, you know, our version of the truth out there as we can. But I think that's where it started. And, you know, I discovered that I really enjoyed it and I liked the traveling that kind of came along with it. And I think the thing that for me has been so educational, and I know for a lot of people feel this way, is just the traveling and seeing, even in the United States, you know, there's so many different sort of pseudo cultures and dialects, and even in architectural terms, you know, there's many different styles and vernaculars that exist in different places, and even methods of construction. You know, we're building at Alice Beach out of this just pure concrete. Even the roof is concrete. Everything's white concrete and stucco. And that's quite a different process to go through. So then building, you know, out of what we call sticks and bricks, you know, in the South. So it's really been fascinating. And it's been a huge learning curve for me that I've really enjoyed it.
So
I get bored easily, so I guess it's the variety's been good.
So where are you from originally in the US? You're from
right
Alabama.
Right here in Alabama. I just kind of, as I like to say it, I grew where I was planted. You know? And I think you know, sure, I thought about moving to New York or out to California. A few times when I was younger, but, you know, one thing and another happened, namely children, that sort of kept me here. And I love the South, and I'm a Southern person at heart. So, I just stayed.
So I find it quite interesting as well, actually, that, you know, a lot, there is obviously on the coasts of the US, this is where the migration of architects tends to happen. People go off to the big cities, Los Angeles, San Francisco, New York, etc.
Yeah.
And I've had the privilege of speaking with a number of architects and even working with some architects in Alabama and Arkansas and some of the southern states. Mm-hmm. What have been some of the benefits of remaining where you are, and what have been some of the challenges?
I think that's a great question. I think probably in some ways, the networking, you know, staying in one place, at least, you know, regionally, was maybe a little bit more thorough. Maybe there's some advantages there, but then at the same time, when you think about the kind of networking that you would be able to do, in a place like New York City, or Los Angeles, California, or hell, even, you know, Dallas, Texas, you know, and the kind of, I like to kind of think of it as a megaphone that you get to kind of speak through, you know, that's a much larger audience and a much larger megaphone that you would, that would be, I would think, or I've imagined anyway, for that to be advantageous above, you know, staying in a, you know, mid-sized southern city like Birmingham. But I think one thing that has been a really interesting game changer in that regard, just in the last decade that you could see, as opposed to even 30 years ago, is just the social media.
Right.
And I know I wouldn't have thought that I would really have been very much into the social media, but when, for whatever reason, I never was much into Facebook that much, but for some reason, when Instagram came out, I had some kind of crazy hippies, I call them, that were working with me at the time, And they said, you got to get on this Instagram thing. And I thought, what the heck is that? And they showed it to me, and I was very skeptical, but then, you know, I created an account and I just started discovering all these people making these amazing products and doing all these incredible and just beautiful photography. And as a visual person, I just went crazy for it. I just totally did the deep dive. That was probably about 2012, 13, 14,
right.
around in that kind of part of the, you know, development. And so that was like 10 years ago. And I just accidentally, you know, sort of stumbled, you know, into it that way. And I started posting pictures of things that I loved or things that inspired me in some of our work. And it just kind of turned into a snowball kind of effect. And man, I mean, I was like religious about it. Once I saw how powerful it was, I was like posting every day, you know, I was posting something. And anyway, you know, fast forward to today, and I mean, I've developed a huge, I would have never imagined, you know, that I'd have whatever, 120,000 people following you on this platform.
Amazing.
But really and truly, nobody's more surprised than me, that kind of thing happened. And, you know, I don't post quite so
well. It's interesting because I mean, I was saying before, you know, you've got one of these portfolios. Your Instagram account is, you know, it is one of these accounts which you can't take your eyes off. It's just filled with all these visual vitamins and delights that become, you know, they're very appealing. But you're also very good at kind of including magazine articles and publications and telling us a little bit of a story about, you know, your personal life and family and things like that. How has your strategy for how do you view it as a communication tool? Do you kind of plot things out or plan things out or?
No, I don't. My strategy is in most of my life has been to just to be myself. Mm-hmm. Because even though I'm not really as interesting as a lot of other people, I'm the best Jeffrey Dungan that there is. And, nobody can beat me at that. So, you know, my strategy's really honestly been just to be me. And I admit that I kind of got to a point where I realized I wasn't really running my Instagram. My Instagram was running me. Mm-hmm. And it sort of gotten into a, you know, maybe not the most positive psychological state about it. And just, you know, I was on there just all the time. And it was a little bit of a distraction, I think, from normal life. And I think we all have to, you know, make our decisions about, you know, how deep down the rabbit hole we're going to go every day. So I sort of stepped a little bit back from it, but that said, I still love it. There's still people I connect with on there. I get a lot of inspiration from people. I mean, not even people that have any. I mean, people that grow flowers. You know, Klaus Dalby. You know, and people that make cakes. You know, and you know, it's just it really is a wonderful way to receive information and see the beautiful, amazing, creative things that people are doing in the world and stay a little bit connected to your friends and your collaborators and different designers and architects that I've come to know and enjoy over the years. So it's still a wonderful source of inspiration to me, but I don't. To answer your question, no, I don't really plan it all out. When I have something good that I want, that I think people would enjoy seeing, I post it.
Do you win work from Instagram directly?
Sometimes, you know, I think, this is a great question. So everybody that's from about 40 and under, when I say, how did you find us? Almost unilaterally, it's Instagram, you know, but from about, you know, 45 to 50 and up, it's, oh, you know, we've followed your work for years, you know, we knew you from here and there. But, I think Instagram is you know, and social media in general is all so part of our life that we don't even know anymore, you know, where we saw that thing or where we first saw it. Pinterest is another one that was really, has really been helpful. You know, we had tons of stuff out there on Pinterest, and people will say, oh, I started, you know, when we started thinking about building a house, we started grabbing, you know, inspirational images off of Pinterest. And we just noticed that, like, who is this Jeffrey Dungan guy? Because, like, you know, a third of our images, we were things we're really drawn to were, you know, pictures of some of your work. And, you know, that's such a humbling thing but such a wonderful thing to make that kind of connection with people just through the work, you know, that that there was something in the work that resonated with them. And that was what, you know, kind of drew them to reach out, and suddenly you have a friend and a client.
You published a book not so long ago, 2018, or was it, a little while ago now,
5 years ago.
The Nature of Home. Was that as a kind of a response to success on Instagram and this visual culture, or was it something you'd always wanted to do?
It's both, actually. That's a really great, you have some good questions. So I think two things. One, I always wanted to do a book. I thought, but later I realized it was a lot of work to do a book because I was determined to write it myself, which was a horrible idea. Mm-hmm. It was a great idea, but it takes a lot of time when you're not a writer to understand what you think and why you do certain things the way you do them, and to sort of plow your heart up enough that you can put words to it, and then to try to make the words, you know, hopefully interesting for people to read. Of course, I had some wonderful editors that that edited what I would write and made more sense of it than I could. But I definitely wanted to be, you know, able to do a book at some point. But as I started doing the Instagram, and I would start to write, you know, about whatever the imagery was or things, I just write a few little blurbs, I realized, man, if you just sort of would develop this and you could paste this all together, I mean, you'd have a book. And so at that point, I think a book started being a little bit more of a palpable thing, or a thing that I felt like maybe was, you know, achievable for me, rather than perhaps something that was just a dream or maybe way out there that I would, you know, probably never really do. But I loved it. I loved the process. Like I said, it took a long time. It took a lot longer than I ever would have imagined that it would. I probably would have been wiser to let somebody else write it, but I wanted to make sure that it was in my voice. There was things I wanted to talk about, and there was no way for somebody else just to sort of extrapolate that out of my mind. And Joan Didion said something wonderful one time. She said, I write entirely to find out what I'm thinking. And I thought, what an amazing statement. And it just kind of made me get chill bumps. But I didn't really understand it until I started to try to write, you know, my own book. And I realized that was really the key, was to figure out what you were thinking and why do you make buildings like this? And why do you love certain things like that? And, you know, some of those journeys, you know, took me all the way back, you know, to my childhood. Is, I think we probably, probably a lot of what we think and believe comes from our formative years.
One of the things that's obviously quite striking about your portfolio of work is how well photographed everything is. Has that been something, I'm assuming you've taken a lot of care of either choosing the photographers, or have you worked with the same photographer over a long period of time?
Yes. Thank you for saying that. I believe that, you know, photography in our age has become sort of incredibly important. And I think we've all, whether we even realize or not, we've all kind of become amateur sort of professional photographers, you know. Even my daughters, you know, their selfies are like, good grief, you know. I mean, they know all the tricks, you know, to shoot high, shoot low, you know, you want the light coming from the sides and not from behind you. I mean, like, you know, and all the, those are good photographic, you know, elements too. But yeah, I think, you know, having a wonderful, the photographer interprets the work. And so what the photographer sees through his or her lens is what the rest of the world is going to see of you. And so, you know, after you've done all of your wrestling for years and years and years to design things and get them built and all that stuff, now this guy shows up for 2 days, you know, or 3 days, and points and clicks, and the story that he or she tells is your story. Mm-hmm. And so it's for those reasons that, you know, I knew that I needed to get to have a really stellar photography in the book. And the other thing that was interesting about it, I was working with a book lady. She was helping me put together kind of the pitch, and she's brilliant. And she said, she's a New Yorker, and she gets me on the phone, and she goes, So Jeffrey, we love your work. Okay. I sent it to my man, and he said, this guy's the real deal. And so I'm like, okay, cool. So, we can do a book. And she says, oh yeah, yeah, you can do a book, but your photography's for shit. you gotta reshoot it. The whole lot of it.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, holy Lord in heaven.
Wow.
It's going to take a long time. It's going to be really expensive. But,
and you're going to you had to get permission from all the clients again. And
oh, it was a journey for sure. But we did it, and it was very good advice, indeed. And so that the photography in the book was all in one hand.
Yes.
So all the words were in my voice, and all the photography was in, you know, the stories that the photography told were consistent, and the light and the methodology and the angles were consistent. And that to me, made a huge difference in the quality.
It's really fascinating you say that, actually, because I speak to a lot of architectural photographers, and we talk about the kind of, you know, the importance of it, and it's, you know, this is something that architects, you can't really afford to skimp on. And one thing that often comes up with is that, you know, working with the same photographer throughout your career can be massively beneficial, because the photographer starts to learn about your work, they start to learn your kind of architectural language, and then you both develop a rapport of how to tell the story of the building. And there's something, again, you know, looking at your, you know, I think the success of your Instagram page, for example, is a very clear indicator of how well curated, powerful images with a very kind of consistent visual flavor to them can be, because that's what kind of it draws in attention, and it holds attention as well. And again, it's very interesting to look at your imagery, the photographs, because they're actually incredibly refreshing in a world of CGI, which is so good nowadays that you can't quite tell the difference whether it's visual representation, is it CGI, or is it actual a real photographic piece of built work. And your work, immediately it's like, it's real, it's breathing, there's something there, I can see taste materials, and then there's a narrative behind the way that the pictures have been put together.
We shot the photographer that shot the book was William Abranovich, Bill, and we we hit it off and right off the bat and became really good friends, which was fortunate because we spent a lot of time together and for quite some time going through all the projects. And and there's probably not two more different people on the planet than Jeffrey Dungan and William Abramovich. One of them's a Jewish guy from New York City, and the other one's a half Irish redneck from Alabama.
Brilliant. And so what was that process of briefing William about your portfolio of work? How did that conversation look, and what was the kind of intention that you were wanting to communicate?
Well, Bill is no shade tree photographer or Johnny come lately to photography. He's been shooting, amazing projects done by incredible architects and interior designers for, decades before we met. So I think what was wonderful about Bill to me was he saw things I didn't even really see, or things that I thought were maybe interesting or whatever, but he always saw something about the work. I get emotional talking about it, but he saw it. And sometimes what it was obvious to me, and sometimes it really wasn't, which was incredible to me that he could see something about, something that I had spent, years creating, and he would catch it in a certain light or in a certain way. And some of my favorite photography that he did was abstract. I mean, he would put the lens in places where it was like, that is the absolutely wrong place to take the picture of this. Like, and he'd do it, and you're like, damn, that's incredible. And so there was this wonderful wonkiness to the way Bill would shoot. And I love asymmetry, but with balance. Balanced asymmetry is a very difficult thing to achieve. And I'm always trying to achieve it in the designs that we do. But with his camera, Bill could also, I did get a little emotional. Bill could also capture that in many ways. And some of the images he got were just, they were just totally abstractions, the way he put the camera in places, and he just didn't even know which way was up. It was art at that moment. It was just art. And, those by and large didn't really make it into the book that much because they weren't really, they're kind of confusing to the story that we were trying to tell, but they were amazing, amazing pieces of art all in themselves. But it was really fun. I realized really quickly he didn't need any help from me. I was much more of an innocent bystander. I would always tell him, okay, Bill, there's two or three bits to this house that I just want to make sure, just humor me and just take this freaking picture right here from right here. Cause this is just to me, this is it. And he'd do it, and he would always oblige me, and then I'd leave him alone and let him go do what he needed to do.
amazing. So again, I think what's really interesting, if I look at this from, put my marketing hat on, this kind of communication of your built work, and actually there's a kind of strong sense of integrity to the process of how you've been wanting to do it, and keeping a consistent voice has been something that obviously has resonated with your target audience, if you like. How generally do people find you, and has the book been a tool in the same sort of way that Instagram has in terms of finding a presence, and what else do you do to promote these images and the story that you created around the work?
Well, I love marketing. I have always been really fascinated with marketing, and I didn't take any business classes in college. So my business training has been, the school of hard knocks and mistakes and doing it better, you know, the next go round. It's been a good education, and I've got the scars to prove it that I've received it. But the marketing parts of it always fascinated me because they deal, I think, largely with psychology and how people think and how people react to words and images, you know. And in that way, it's, you know, marketing is quite simple. You have words and images, but those things convey ideas and communicate whole worlds and philosophies, to the mind of the receiver. And I find that absolutely fascinating. So that's probably the part I've focused on, you know, especially early on, more than anything. And I still work with some wonderful publicists on, you know, both coasts that I help me continue to get our name out there in various and sundry ways. I think at this point, though, because of, and you asked about Instagram versus the book, I think it's kind of it's both. Mm-hmm. They're kind of like bookends, maybe, you know. One's kind of more permanent and maybe more stately. Mm-hmm. I would think the book is sort of in those terms. And then the other one is a little bit more fluid, and ever changing. Like I said earlier, you know, there's lots of negative parts to social media too that have been well documented by intelligent people. So I won't get all into that. But I think at this point, I just want to make sure that the level of the work, that there's still the same desire and striving for excellence in the work, and that then we continue to communicate things in ways that are eternal, and so that they resonate with who they resonate with. But I think to be timeless, you have to always be communicating in ways that are eternal and using more of a philosophy of the words and the meanings being eternal.
Mm, beautiful. It's interesting as well. Again, there is a very, it's easy for architects as well to get lost, for example, in their visual communication and end up communicating very well to other architects. Mm. Whereas you're doing both here very well. And there's something, obviously, that the visual information and the story is resonating with the people that want to be your clients. It's not alienating. And I like this idea that there's something eternal that you're trying to communicate. What is the kind of emotional intent that you're trying to connect with people for your marketing?
Well, I think emotionally we always want to communicate the ideas of there's lots of them. I think authenticity is a word that's been sort of probably overused, but I still don't have a better word for it, so I'll still use it. I think that the use of materials and strategies that are authentic and proportions that to me are eternal and speak to a human scale are incredibly important. There's some wonderful lessons, in classical architecture, about that, and been really fortunate and blessed to receive some awards from the Institute for Classical Art and Architecture Even though I don't think most people, when they would look at our work, they would say, well, that's classical architecture. But I think in many of the tenets of classical architecture that we ascribe to, those elements that are so wonderful about classical architecture are present. Mm-hmm. You know, proportion and restraint, I think, are two that I'm always thinking about and trying to be more and more aware of. Materials that are timeless, you know, stones sort of unilaterally hard to beat, and roof lines and massing that make people feel that pique people's interest and feel like what one of my friends calls a gift to the street. Mm-hmm. I think you know, the golden section, the rule of thirds, which is used in photography, you know, even on Instagram, when you look at the little viewfinder, it's broken into thirds, both vertically and horizontally. I mean, it's not just a grid. There's a reason for that. Mm-hmm. And for whatever reason, the way humans, our minds operate, we see beauty in certain proportions, and it's fairly mathematical. Mm-hmm. And that's just sewn into our DNA. And so to me, those are things that are eternal. And so I'm trying to bring that into the work. And then if the words we use are also those eternal kind of words, and they're authentic in their delivery. And when you look at the work, you see those elements present and those qualities present, then I think the message starts to ring like the truth, mm-hmm. you know, which is another wonderful eternal thing. And I think that's powerful to people. And I think the rest of it, you let the people come to you, you know, mm-hmm. that people are kind of like cats, you know, you can't just call them. You have to let them come to you, or it works at least better that way. Mm-hmm.
Do you feel that the kind of architectural languages that you work in are also the kind of languages that the type of demographic that you work for or work with prefer or have a taste for or have an understanding of?
I think the last part, the last phrase that you use, have an understanding of, you know, what I think a big part of what I'm interested in doing is creating architecture that feels familiar mm-hmm. to people. There's in the lines, in the materials, in the detailing, in the massing, there's definitely things, and there's a process, excuse me, that feels familiar. And when things feel familiar, people feel comfortable, right? And that's a wonderful feeling. And I think, you know, by and large, what we're doing is creating residential, you know, places. And so comfort is, I mean, that's a very important component or element of any home. We want to feel comfortable there. And so I think if right off the bat, you can start to feel comfortable with a building just from your first view of it, because it has some of those things that people understand mm-hmm. and know, I think you're halfway there. You know, the Italians say, if you're tall, you're halfway to beautiful. I love that, you know. And what do they mean? Well, who the hell knows? They're Italians. But, you know, what I take from that is that there's an elegance to things that are vertically proportioned mm-hmm. or more vertically proportioned than perhaps squattier things. Mm-hmm. And I think when you do things that feel familiar, you're already halfway there. So now the trick becomes, because if I just continue down that line of thinking, then all I'm really doing, or all I really end up doing, is regurgitating things that we've already all seen and known and done. So the artistic and creative move becomes in, now, how can I do this thing that feels like it's from 1920 or 1820 and now do it for 2020, right? So what is it about this thing? What do I have to say as a thinker and a creative person living in, you know, whatever century this is? What comments and what, I call it, it's kind of like putting a spin on the ball, right? History hits the ball into my court. I'm hitting it back, but I'm putting my spin on it this time.
Yeah.
I'm not merely regurgitating things. I'm recreating them, in maybe just a very small way. Maybe it's just a subtle thing, or maybe I'm even bringing in some other elements from, a nearer history of like the 50s or the 60s, some mid-century, you know, elements, let's say, or some more what we would call clean modern elements, to mix into the history that is the overall sort of vibe that we might be creating. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if I really answered your question, but that's kind of, that's the, I think, the backdrop or the philosophical thinking and why I think it's important, to the work that, to the designs that we do.
I think
it does resonate with people. I think it does.
And I think that's what's so kind of compelling and interesting, about the work. There's so many architects who unintentionally alienate audiences, or perhaps are not always thinking about end user groups, or they're not necessarily, they might be more individualistic, if you like, with the language, the architectural language that they're using or inventing. And this can unintentionally kind of create a culture gap. And I think as a business person, we do need to understand, you know, where people are at, like what do people want? We're also creative people, so we need to listen to the integrity of our art, like how you're talking about. I remember listening to I think it was David Bowie in an interview, and he was talking about how he often imagines his songs being heard from the audience. And I was like, that's a great marketeer.
That's amazing. Yeah.
That's a great marketeer. He's thinking about how the audience is going to respond to that. And you watch the film, the discography of the film, the Queen film as well. And there's that conversation where they're imagining how the audience is going to participate with the song. And I think as a creative person, that's really important to start to imagine, you know, where is the audience? How are they going to respond to it? As opposed to just being completely isolated and it being about me and my input and so that's going to be given to the world. And as a marketeer, that's massively important. We must be able to understand the kind of thoughts and feelings of our potential clients.
Yeah.
I move the conversation in a different direction here and talk about how does all of this kind of the philosophy, the integrity to the craftsmanship and the work that you do, being very thoughtful and considered in how you're communicating your message, how do you keep these projects profitable?
Well, I just charge a lot of money. I always tell my clients, if I ever save you a nickel, I didn't mean to.
I love it.
I think seriously, obviously you are running a business, and there's no business that can be stable without a steady stream of income. And I have a chart that they, that my office managers do for me every month. And there's three or four lines on there, but there's just two lines I look at. And one line is how much we're spending, and the other one is how much income we have. And if those two lines ever cross, I'm in trouble. And so far, you know, for the most part, for 25 years almost, I've kept those two lines away from each other. Mm-hmm. I think there's lots of ways to manage that and to create, you know, the sustainable, you know, business model. And there's lots of places, to save money. I think on the business side, efficiency to me is so important. Mm-hmm. And I think that's where lots of times we can get in trouble as architects, because, you know, at the end of the day, it's an odd thing. This is obviously me speaking, so these are my theories about it. Somebody else may have a very different concept, but my concept is that we don't actually produce buildings; we draw buildings. I don't swing a hammer. I don't pour concrete. I don't lay rebar. I don't do cabinetry. But we create the vision, and we create a very large, thick set of drawings that's basically a recipe that, if followed more or less, will create hopefully a cake that tastes really good. Mm-hmm. You know, or a building in our case that looks quite beautiful and functions really well and stands the test of time and all those things. So what we're creating really is the drawings. And so the faster that we can move through that process, or a better word, and the word I actually use is efficient. So the more efficiently we can move through that process. Why efficient instead of speed? I was watching this really cool interview with some like Chinese guy up in the mountains that was making these amazing little, you know, handmade tiles using like, you know, technology from 100 years ago, and they were amazing. Everybody was, you know, loving them and buying them. And they said to the guy, like, you know, you could do this like way faster if you use, you know, these things. And he just paused and kind of looked down at the ground. And he said, well, there's a disease called speed. And I thought that guy's figured something out really important. So there's a difference in speed and efficiency, because you can draw something maybe really fast, but you're going to be probably making quite a few mistakes. Mm-hmm. If you just try to go fast. So the game is to try to do it efficiently and not always be going back over the same thing. Now, we all know that we're going to go back over the same thing. I mean, at least 2 or 3 times, but to me, that's the important part of it. And so how can we develop systems and, you know, processes that, that tend to, keep us out of a ditch, mm-hmm. And help us kind of take the next step forward. So that's been, probably the biggest part of my work in terms of creating profit, or profitable, businesses, to, just be careful to, be very thoughtful about listening, mm-hmm. To the client, because at the end of the day, they're the ones that pay us, and they're the ones that we're designing for. As you said earlier, it's not about me. It's not about us. It's about them. And so we do a lot of work on the front end. And even before we even sign up to do the project, we'll spend quite a bit of time with them, really making sure that we understand and document what they told us that they wanted. And, there's spreadsheets, and we get really granular about it and very detailed in terms of every single room, the square footages, all that stuff. so that we can then execute that. And then if there are changes to it, and there always are small ones, but if they're big, then we have a recourse to kind of have a different kind of conversation with the client about what we agreed to do on the front end. And that has been incredibly helpful to our process, and it's helped us to not have to design the house three times just to get it built once. And I think therein lies, you know, a big help to the secret of profitability.
You mentioned at the start of that, actually, that you know, you charge a lot. You make sure that you charge a lot of money, and that's the kind of, I like that, because that's the first part of being efficient, is to make sure that you're asking for the right amount of money in the first place, and or at least have mechanisms to be able to ask more when you know you need more. And so many practices actually fail at that first hurdle, and it doesn't matter then what processes and systems they've got in place, because there's nothing to manage. They're trying to be efficient with too little, and now they're on the back foot. How do you ensure from the outset that you are, number one, charging a premium, or you're charging the right amount? What kind of process do you go through? How do you broach this part of the conversation with clients? Does it turn people off many times if you say, you know what, look, we're not cheap, we are an expensive firm?
I really don't think we I mean, these sums are, you know, not small, but relative to our industry, they're fair, and they're not the highest end of what architects that, you know, do the level of work that we do charge. So, you know, there's a level of fairness to it, but, you know, I mean, I grew up on a farm, so I mean, I never dreamt that I'd be dealing with, you know, numbers the size of the projects that we do. I think to get to your question and some kind of plausible answer, I always try to have a range of a fee structure that has a range to it. So there's already some built-in flexibility. So there's kind of like a low end that, by and large, it doesn't make sense, business sense for me, to go lower than. And then there's a top end that's reserved for projects that might be on the verge of being the size of projects or the you know, type of projects that we would do, but for a moderately increased fee, it could still make sense if somebody really wants to work with us. At the end of the day, any fee conversation has to work for two people, me and them, and more importantly for them, right? In some way. So they have the ability to say, well, that's, you know, just more than what we want to spend. But I get told at least once a week that we're kind of expensive. So I'm like, yeah, I get that. And, you know, I wish we could all just, you know, do it for free, but I'd probably still do it, but don't tell anybody I said that. Cause of course we love what we do. But I think that people find, you know, that as long as you're being reasonable, but at the same time, here's the thing, you have to know your worth. And if you don't know your worth, then you have a real big problem, because you're going to find out what you're worth by somebody else telling you what you're worth. And, you know, except for in very rare instances, they probably don't think you're worth what you need to be worth to make sense and to make business sense of the kinds of arrangements that you make with people.
How do you charge? Do you have a preference to using, say, fixed fee or percentage of construction or hourly billing?
It's generally, I'd say most of the time, it's a percentage of the cost of construction arrangement in, you know, in a range of, you know, that might be, maybe there's 4 or 5 percentage points between, you know, the low end and the high end. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's not dissimilar from, you know, basically in the way I describe it to people who haven't really dealt with an architect before, it's very similar to the fee that you're going to pay the builder. Mm-hmm. You know, when you get right down to it. And so I'm at least equating some equality to the work that we do with the importance of hiring the right builder. Mm-hmm. I think that makes sense to people.
I do like percentage billing for an architect on the construction value, because it tends to be a fair representation of the amount of work that you're putting in. It's not an exact science. But one of the problems with it is it's incredibly difficult to communicate this to a client. And certainly if you're doing something where, you know, the you've done a whole load of work and the fee and the construction value has shot up over a period of, you know, a few months whilst you've been working, and now you're billing the client against something, and the you know, what you're sending out as an invoice now becomes a bit of a shock to them. How do you communicate this? Because this can be the cause of so many fallouts and upset. Yeah. And
I think I can tell that you've done this before, because you know all the great questions to ask about all the little gotchas and some of the challenges, the details of the challenges even, of being an architect in this industry, in this time, where at least recently, you know, in the last, let's say, 3 or 4 years, construction costs have increased at a rate that's never been seen before, you know, in history. And so, of course, you know, the architects, that are, you know, fees being based on percentages of costs of construction, have, you know, participated in, you know, that beneficial beneficial way, relative to their fees. But here's the thing. There's a, I'm Southern and I love colloquial sayings, so I'm going to give you one. Hogs get fat, but pigs get slaughtered. So you want to, it's okay to be a hog, but don't be a pig, right? Or you get slaughtered. So what I'm saying is, be fair with the clients, in the same way that you have to maybe, on the front end, have some conversations where you have to kind of stand up for yourself and what you know that your worth is. When you get into those situations where, you know, you agreed to do it and your fee came out to a number, it always ends up being a number. Here's the number, mm-hmm. In dollars and cents. And you agreed to do that. And you get down the road 6 months or whatever, and if nothing else has really changed, you know, the house didn't get more complicated, the project didn't get more complicated, didn't get bigger, you know, you just did what you agreed to do. But suddenly, you know, the cost of construction has risen, you know, some value. You just have to look at yourself in the mirror and say, you know, is it fair for me to charge them this much more money for the same job that I agreed to do 6 months ago? And a lot of times there's extenuating circumstances and the project also has gotten bigger. There's a lot of different things. I'm not saying that that's a cut and dried thing, but I just know that when I look at myself in the mirror in the morning, I know I'm not taking advantage of my clients. Mm-hmm. And my clients know that because I make sure to tell them. Well, they see it, because when we get the new number, when we get the revised number, and we've started out here and now the construction cost is here, and they see that I actually change my number so that they don't take the entirety of that hit. I can't tell you how much that means to them. And so now we're just talking about, I mean, we're talking about business, but we're also talking about, you know, people remember that stuff. Mm-hmm. And I just think at the end of the day, you know, you do what's fair. And sometimes that means that you change your fee to be fair to your client, and they'll never forget it.
Amazing. And it's the perfect place to conclude the conversation there, Jeff. We've come to the end of our time, but thank you so much for inviting us in and allowing us to get a little glimpse of your expertise and world of your practice. It's been really, really insightful and wonderful to hear. So thank you very much.
Good. Thanks for all the great questions. And I really enjoyed talking. It's always fun. And I'm always surprised that anybody wants to know what I think about anything. So it's kind of fun. Awesome. I hope you have a wonderful Thanksgiving holiday with your friends and family.
Thank you very much. You too.
And that's a wrap. Oh yeah, one more thing. If you haven't already, head on over to iTunes and leave a review. We'd love to read your name out here on the show. This episode is sponsored by Smart Practice, the world's leading step-by-step business training program that's helped more than 103 architecture firm owners structure their existing practice so the complexity of business doesn't get in the way of their architecture. Because you see, it's not your architecture or design skills that's holding you back. It's the complexity of running a business, managing projects and people, dealing with clients, contractors, and money. So if you're ready to simplify the running of your practice, go to businessofarchitecture.com/smart to discover the proven, simple, and easy to implement smart practice method for running a practice that doesn't get in the way of doing exceptional architecture. The views expressed on the show by my guests do not represent those of the host, and I make no representation, promise, guarantee, pledge, warranty, contract, bond, or commitment except to help you conquer the world. Carpe diem.